G'day, I'm John Slattery. I've been in Canandra all my life. I was born here in 1944, reared in South Canandra. I left school at a fairly early age when I turned 14 and went out to work. I played football for Canandra here during the 60s, back when they used to play in First Division. Going back to my growing up days in South Canandra, everything was so simple over there then. All dirt roads, and we all had our bloody billy carts and things, and all the neighbours around there, they were all hard workers like drovers. And one of my favourite neighbours was Porter Rice down the corner. We used to get our milk from him every morning. That was my job, to get down and get the milk before school. He used to milk probably 10 or a dozen cows there or something like that. And as he milked each cow, he'd just open the gate and let them straight out on the road. That's quite hilarious now, because I'm the local poundkeeper for the Cabon Shire now. I mean, I'd had a bloody field day with him back in them days. I'd toddle down the road with me billy can each morning to get the milk and walk in and, "Good morning, Mr. Rice." And he'd be there, he'd have his old head buried in the flank of a cow, pulling its tits and working a bit of milk in the buckets, and I'd pass him my little billy can in. And mainly in the winter times, it's a bit dodgy sort of thing, you know, it used to worry me a little bit, because Porter had his head in the flank of an old cow and his head down, and little icicles used to form on the point of his nose, and I'd stand there and watch them. As each one slowly dripped to the ground, I'd think, missed the bucket that time. Whoops, there goes one in the bucket. But it only happened occasionally. But I'd go home and tell Mum about it, and she'd say, "Oh, it's only a bit of sweat off Mr. Rice's forehead. It won't hurt you." As it turned out, it didn't hurt us anyhow, but he was my favourite old neighbour, old Porter. He'd always tell us kids a yarn or two, but those little icicles on the end of his nose used to bother me. Anyway, my working days was consisted of hay carting and fencing and all sorts of stuff like that, stock work. But when I was hay carting, I worked with blokes like Jack Esmond and Jack Rice, who were probably two of the best hay carters in the district. I'd back them against anyone. That Esmond, he could place a bale anywhere and never raise a sweat. But Jack Rice, he was every bit as good, I reckon. But I remember one time we were carting hay. It was a Christmas Eve, actually. We wanted to knock off by about 2 o'clock. Jack said he wanted to get back to town and do a bit of shopping, buy his wife something for Christmas. At any rate, we're down at Killarney on the Rivers Road. There was 1,500 bales in the paddock, had to be shedded. So we hooked into it, and it was stinking hot. And I remember I was throwing the last load off, and the sun was beaming down. I had the throw off about too high, and I just looked up at Big Jack and said, "Listen, mate, I don't think I can finish this. We're going to have to go around to the shady side of the shed. I don't think I can carry on." And he said, "I'm bloody glad you said that, mate, because that was my next statement to you." But he said, "I'm glad you said it first." So we moved around the shady side of the shed and continued to throw the last bit off there. But that was a hard day's yakka, that was. In the early 70s there, a bunch of us got together and decided to start a radio going in Canandra. All during 74 and that, we cut timber out in the hills, and every weekend for about 18 months, I think it was, we'd go out the hills there, getting posts and rails and that. We took the draft horses out there and things like that, and dragging the logs down out of the hills. Someone drew up a set of plans for the radio yards, Bruce Watt actually, I think that was, and they were a real good team of blokes. There was blokes like Croc and Robbie Watt and Johnny and Robbie Lawrence and, you know, the Rice boys and Reggie Watt and Jack Esmond. We built a good set of yards over there and held our first couple of rodeos, and they were beauties. And after a few years, they started to die down a little bit. I started drawing to a bit of a close around about early 80s, I suppose, you know. We used to raise more money for the rodeos to run them and that. We used to run balls and socials and things like that. Every long weekend, we'd have a social at one of the local clubs, the golf club or the bowling club. We used to use bands, or mainly a local band from Ringanee, like Joe Flannery had a band going, and Joe was one of our favourite singers. He would sing all night until the early hours of the morning. Any request you threw at him, he could handle it, sort of thing. And they were good nights, the socials. But our balls, we used to run one of them every year. The old favourite saying was that the Bushmen's always had the biggest balls, mainly for the simple reason, and the only reason, was that the most people used to turn up at the Bushman's balls. Once or twice a year, we'd organise a ride out to the hills for two or three or four nights or something like that. We'd either go out to Nengar Hills and overlook the gap there, which is a beautiful spot just on the western side of Canandra. Other trips were out at the Needles, up the top end of the Balabula River. That was a real good spot, that was. Beautiful stream running down there, and a nice big sandbar type of thing just in on the edge of the water there. A good area of sand. And just one occasion comes to mind. We're out there, probably 18 or 20 of us. We're all sitting around the campfire there in a circle, all swapping yarns and telling stories and what have you. At any rate, we're sitting around there, a few ales under our belt sort of thing, and somebody produced a flagon of wine. But it sort of started going around the circle, and there was a few comments made about it, not a bad drop this. And Next thing I look up, there's another two flagons. Where they come from, I don't know. But at any rate, they proceed to go around the circle while we're all yarning there. And I remember Dick Marsh made a statement something like, good stuff, this. I don't think I'll ever drink beer again. So a couple more laps around the circle, these flagons went, and I heard Dick say it again. Good stuff, this. I don't think I'll ever drink beer again. A little bit later, I look up and Dick's just sort of wandered away from the camp a little bit over towards where the sandbar is. He sort of lost his foot in the bit and down he went. And I made a comment about it and everyone sort of laughed, but we weren't worried because he's on the sand. He made a few feeble attempts to get back up again, but he couldn't handle it. So he stayed on the sand, so we left him there. A bit later on, I looked over and he's laying on his belly. And someone said, I think Dick looks like he's going to be crook. So with that, I see Dick dig a bit of a hole under his chest in the sand, and he proceeded to have a bit of a spit in there. At any rate, just like an old cat, he covered it back over again and moved on another metre or so up along the sandbank. The same thing happened again. Another bit of a hole. He has another bit of a spit in that hole. Same thing, like an old cat, covered up again. But at any rate, this probably happened 10 or a dozen times, I reckon. We were all there watching him and thought, well, leave him there because he's not going to choke. He's laying on his belly and can't hurt himself. A bit later on, Reggie Watt and myself decided we'd better pick him up and put him in the back of this old Valiant that was parked between the trees there. So we drug him over and shoved him in the back seat and said, you better sleep it off in there, mate. And he didn't have no, you know, argument against that. Next morning, we're sitting around the campfire there again and all feeling a bit sorry for our bloody selves. And Dick poked his head out the back of this old Valiant and made some sort of a comment. We looked around and he didn't look too good. And there was something a bit odd about him that I couldn't quite pick up at the time because I wasn't feeling all that crash hot myself. But then he said, anybody see my teeth anywhere? His false teeth, they were missing. And then I realised that's what the funny, what the odd look was about him. They were gone. He was a bit gummy. But at any rate, someone said, there must be one of those holes that you were digging last night. So with that, Jack Esmond grabbed a shovel and, well, he shifted that big sandbar from one side of the river to the other a couple of times. Needless to say, he didn't find the teeth. But another bloke, Steve Kane, always had a habit of bringing two mongrel blue dogs with him. We're sitting up there having a bit more of a yarn and someone looked around. They said, hey, the dog, get a look at the dog. And when we looked around, here's the dog. He dug the teeth up and he got them in his mouth. I looked at Dick and, well, his old eyes lit up. He went over and spoke to the dog gently and the dog just dropped the teeth back on the sand. With that, Dick just picked them up, looked at them, and he went down to the river and gave him a bit of a wash in the river and got the sand and a bit of slobber off him and back in his mouth. And, well, it certainly improved his looks again. And to this day, I don't think Dick's ever drank wine again. He just sticks to his twoies.